Now, I'm sure my opponents can give you a long, long list of all the wonderful things about trade. And you know what? I agree with them. But it's not trade that's up for debate. It's free trade. That is trade without appropriate regulation. Now, some economists, by their own admission, simply don't care about the economic interests of Americans because they believe in an ideology that says it's morally wrong to do so. I'm basically talking about libertarians and globalists, which are not the same thing. So they are, by their own admission, pursuing a different objective. And it's just not that rational for Americans to take their advice. If they want to offer policies that are good for the whole world at the expense of the US, that's fine. But they're answering a different question. Now, these guys have a related factual premise, which is the same. Namely, that there's no difference between what's good for foreigners and what's good for Americans. Because there's no such thing as international economic rivalry. But the fact is that economic rivalry is something you can see every day. It's not some giant illusion that people hallucinate and need to be disabused of. We don't live in a zero-sum world in which our loss is always someone else's gain and vice versa. But there is still rivalry over wealth and income that either we get or they get. This is true in your personal life, in your career, in your business, and it's true in international economics for many of the same reasons. Now, some people will say political borders are economically meaningless. But the reality is you and I live in America. So if you want to be indifferent to the economic success of the US, you can just take that nice job in Singapore the next time you're unemployed. I'm sorry, but it does matter where you live. Nations haven't become economically irrelevant, and they won't become irrelevant as long as they're relevant to the economic fates of the people who live in them. America's trade deficit, which is the difference between our exports and our imports, is around $500 billion a year. Because the trade deficit is the single best measure of our trade problems, this means that free trade is a big problem. It's a number comparable to federal budget deficits. Some of the aspects of this problem sound technical, so it's tempting sometimes to let your eyes glaze over. But it underlies a lot of more visible problems. When you look at poverty, for example, and drive through rundown cities and towns, free trade's a part of that. Not the whole thing, but it's a part of it. When you look at family breakdown because of poverty, free trade is ultimately a part of that too. The first thing that free trade is doing to America right now is destroy jobs. When goods are produced abroad and imported, production jobs are there, obviously. Now, clearly this would be okay if we were gaining other jobs due to our exports, which free traders always talk about, but we're not, because there's this huge trade deficit, so we have a huge net loss of jobs. It's the net figure you've got to keep your eye on. Always remember that when you read discussions of this issue. It sounds simple, but it's ignored so often. Free traders will tell you that it's okay for us to lose jobs then, because unemployed people will eventually go to work someplace else. Which is true, but it means people losing $28 an hour jobs producing automobiles and getting $8 an hour jobs flipping hamburgers. So we're looking at a decline in the quality more than the raw quantity of jobs here. The second thing that free trade is doing to America right now is deindustrialization. This means not just job loss, but the loss of entire plants and then entire industries. There's a myth being promoted that we're only losing quote-unquote primitive industries like basic steel manufacturing, which if you know your steel is not as primitive as people think, but still. But that just isn't true anyway. Boeing is losing the manufacture of aircraft wings to Mitsubishi of Japan. I mean, does that sound primitive to you? This, as Greg was telling you, is a big national security problem. free trade means we have no defense against militarily important industries being stripped away from us. There's not a single plane in the U.S. Air Force today that isn't dependent upon components made by potentially hostile nations. And the military and civil industrial bases are related, so if you weaken one, you weaken the other. China knows this perfectly well, and they have a strategy documented in considerable detail to use trade as a weapon of long-term military advantage against the U.S. Now, remember, when we say free trade, we really mean quote-unquote free trade, because trade isn't really free. It's basically free on America's side because we have very few trade barriers to imports anymore. But it's not free in the other direction because foreign nations manipulate their trade in a million ways. America's tariffs are well under 1% of the volume of our imports. So we really are free traders. But many foreign nations practice something called mercantilism, which is an economic strategy going back hundreds of years of gaming the system in international trade. This gets done in blatant and cynical ways by nasty, hard-edged governments like China, but, which is a part Greg didn't tell you about, it also gets done in a polite, disingenuous way by politically correct governments like Germany. But it certainly gets done. They even admit it when they're talking to their own people and don't think foreigners are listening. It's documented. So, how is trade manipulated? Well, for a start, governments engage in currency manipulation to control the price of their currencies. If you make a nation's currency artificially cheap, you'll increase that nation's exports and reduce its imports. China did this for years and years. Japan is still doing it. The entire euro currency is, to some extent, a giant currency manipulation scheme for Germany because it blends Germany's natural currency, the Deutsche Mark, with the currencies of a lot of other nations, like France and Italy, that don't have Germany's strong export performance and therefore naturally have cheaper currencies. Trade also gets manipulated inside national economies, too. For example, in Korea, if you buy a foreign car, it's well known that this tends to trigger a tax audit by the Korean equivalent of the IRS. So, people get the message, and they don't buy foreign cars. In Germany, the major banks tend to hold the shares of both companies and their suppliers. So, if, for example, BMW tried to buy tires from an American firm rather than a German one, their bank would say, "You idiot, this company we own part of will go bankrupt, so knock it off." Some people get the message. There are a lot of understandings, gentlemen's agreements. There's cronyism, and national governments are all for it. That's part of how the system works over there. And given that they're doing well in trade, and we're in a state of crisis, why should they give it up? The reality is, the U.S. right now is being forced to compete with foreign state capitalism. Some people will tell you that state capitalism just can't work, but I'm sorry, that's just empirically false. State capitalist countries are getting very rich, and they're kicking our butts in trade. So, why doesn't the U.S. do anything about its trade problems? In large part, this is because, quote, American multinational corporations simply aren't American companies anymore. They get given this pass because they may be headquartered here, and they're allowed to roam the halls of Congress as if they were Americans. But frankly, that's just the location of the CEO's office. And they like the situation just fine. As I mentioned before, you really do have to ask sometimes whether the person you're dealing with even cares about the American economy. Free traders love to make excuses. All these problems, we're imagining them, is what they say. So they'll tell you sometimes the trade deficit doesn't matter. This is a tempting story to believe because everybody likes a free lunch. And ultimately, the idea that the trade deficit doesn't matter amounts to the idea that Americans can get free stuff somehow by magic. So it's important to just think through the basic logic of it. The trade deficit basically means that we consume more than we produce, and we import goods to make up the difference. Now, when America imports goods from abroad, we have to pay for those goods in one of three ways. First, we can export goods, and that's what foreigners get in return. Second, we can transfer ownership of assets we've produced already. And that's when we give foreigners things like shares in Google or part ownership of a shopping center in San Diego. Third, we can give foreigners goods we promised to produce in the future. And that's when we borrow money and go into debt to foreigners. So it's either goods we produce today, yesterday, or tomorrow. And that's it. One of these things must be happening, else we must be trading with the North Pole, because Santa is the only person who gives away things for free. As a result, when America runs a trade deficit, it is intrinsically something that makes us poorer over time, simply because we owe more and we own less. Our net worth is lower. That's just accounting, it's not even economics. And any contrary view is magical free lunch theory. So the trade deficit basically amounts to America living beyond its means. If it's a sustained thing, not just a fluctuation, it's a form of decadence. Now, one thing you also need to watch out for when arguing about free trade is when people fake simplify the analysis. Free traders love to oversimplify because they don't want you to hear what the details might tell you. Their argument basically comes down to any act of trade that is a voluntary exchange must have been good for both sides. Well, by that standard, it's good for a starving man to sell his shoes. Okay, maybe in the moment it is, but you're ignoring the question of how he got into the circumstances that forced him into that trade in the first place. The policy question we face is not just whether to do one particular trade, but what circumstances we want ourselves to be in when we do, what bargaining position we want to have, because that will determine whether or not our trades are less advantageous than they should have been. Sometimes free traders will try to intellectually intimidate you with economic arguments that sound too technical for you to understand and pick apart. But the key is this. It's usually not the argument itself that is the problem. It's usually the hidden assumptions underlying it. The conclusions follow from the premises, but the premises are either wrong or at best highly questionable. For example, the key economic theory here, which Greg mentioned briefly, is the so-called theory of comparative advantage, which goes back to the 19th century British economist David Ricardo. And I identified 8 hidden assumptions in my book that it has. Assumptions like trade is broadly balanced over time. That is, there's no chronic huge trade deficit. Another assumption is that capitalism mobile between nations, which it certainly is today, and which Ricardo himself admitted would constitute an exception to his argument. Another assumption is that capital and labor flow freely between industries in this country. So if trade kills off one industry, workers can just easily shift to another, and the unemployed auto workers in Michigan can go build helicopters. But they can't. Another assumption is that there are no so-called externalities, which is an economist's term for where the price of something doesn't accurately reflect its value. So you're assuming that nobody's gaining a price advantage by ignoring environmental problems. No industries are special because they lead to the industries of the future, and if you lose them, you can't get to that future. Another hidden assumption is that free trade has no effect on income inequality. But it does. And another assumption is that free trade won't build up your foreign competitors and make them even more potent rivals. But I think you understand it pretty obviously well. cease to grant all these dubious hidden assumptions, the math underlying free trade ceases to work. You lose the purported proof that free trade is always best, and you arrive at the conclusion that it's sometimes good for you and sometimes not. So, a nation needs strategic, not unconditional, integration into the world economy. It needs protectionism as part of its policy toolkit some of the time. Now, America used to understand this perfectly well. This is not some exotic discovery I made. Free traders will often tell you that free trade is somehow the American way, sweet land of liberty, etc., etc. So it comes as a shock to a lot of people to learn that, in fact, if you look at the real history, protectionism is actually the American way. All of the founding fathers were protectionists, explicitly so. And Lincoln was a protectionist. Teddy Roosevelt. The U.S. had a tariff-protected economy from its founding until after World War II. During that time, we grew from being a third-world backwater to being the greatest industrial economy the world had ever seen. Which is kind of inexplicable if protectionism is this terrible policy that ruins economies. The great protectionist among the founding fathers was Alexander Hamilton, the guy on the $10 bill, the first Treasury Secretary, and the intellectual architect of American capitalism. So we have here some evidence from economic history that there might be something wrong with economic theory. Economic history has this amazing way of putting purely theoretical constructs to the test and telling you things people don't want you to know. Now, in fairness, there are economists and economic theories that have the right idea about this stuff. In fact, a lot of economists are actually considerably less stupid on these issues than the kind of economists you get on the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal. Plenty of economists know that free trade has very serious problems, but they tend to clam up in public because they're afraid the public will get the wrong idea and impose some stupid kind of protectionism. And I'd like to emphasize that I'm well aware of that danger, and it's not what I'm in favor of. Now, the really interesting thing is there's nothing special or exotic about America's protectionist history. Every country that has become a major economic power has done this, starting with England in the 17th century and continuing on to China and other countries today. There are variations between countries, of course, but it's a standard playbook. We used to understand it, and we forgot. What happened? Well, after World War II, we threw our markets open to the rest of the world for purely political reasons in order to win the Cold War. We wanted to prop up foreign nations' economies and bind them to dependence upon us as an export market so that they wouldn't get close to the Soviet Union. But there was never a point when economists suddenly figured out, hey, protectionism we've had for 150 years is now wrong, and free trade is now right. That never happened. It was all politics, rationalized as economics after the fact. So the consensus in favor of free trade is really a political construct. It's not an economic truth, which is precisely why it's crumbling under political pressure today on both sides of the partisan divide, which I did predict 6 years ago in my book, when nobody had heard of Trump or Sanders or Hillary repudiating, at least in words, the Trans-Pacific Partnership that she personally negotiated as Secretary of State. Now, I'm the last guy on earth to deny that there can be stupid forms of protectionism. I'm not in favor of them. But free traders will tell you things like a tariff intrinsically leads to political interference in the economy. That's not necessarily so. For example, I said in my book that I favor a flat tariff, which would be the same on all imports, so there's no opportunity for political mischief. Of course, there are dangers with protectionism, but there are dangers at this point with doing nothing. If we keep on doing nothing, our economy will continue to decline. We won't be a superpower if we don't have a first-class industrial base. We'll be like a North American Brazil. In any case, if you want to talk about political mischief, these free trade agreements, like the Trans-Pacific Partnership, are even worse than free trade itself. For a start, they're not really free trade agreements anyway, given that America has basically already opened up its markets and foreign nations have no intention of doing so. These treaties are mainly about protecting various property rights, foreign investors, patents, copyrights. I call this Disney's drug crisis. But the WTO, World Trade Organization, has a completely failed track record at enforcing free trade on nations that don't want to practice it. They only successfully enforce obligations on nations like the United States, which actually take their legal obligations seriously and have court systems that will do so. Oh, and then these trade agreements enable unelected foreign judges to interfere with the right of Americans to make our own laws. So it's a violation of both our sovereignty and of American democracy. It's a threat to things like our environmental laws and our laws protecting us against the next financial crisis. So even if you're in favor of free trade itself, you should still oppose the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Thank you very much for listening.